And what a great victory that is and will be one glorious day. Join me in Matthew 6:19-21. Matthew 6:19-21. I subscribe to Apple Music, and I've got this massive playlist. I think it's 2.5 days long. If you listen to all the songs, so I just have it scrambled, shuffled, that's the word I want. And just so happened on the way here this morning, I heard the country song, God Bless Texas. You know that song? And he certainly has, and he's blessed us this morning to be here and to honor God. I want to thank RJ. We had some problems with the streaming, with the video, and that's fixed, but it's a blessing and a curse. Blessing is folks at home have video. Curse is they have to see me. And but we're thankful that's working. Speaking of blessings and cursings, when RJ was, right before RJ was born, Tammy and I went to a Saturn dealership and bought us a new car. I'd always wanted a Saturn. And so we went and we got a Saturn. And Tammy was driving it to work. It was her car. And there was a problem. She did not like the stereo that came with the car. And so Christmas that year, I borrowed her car to run some errands. I really went to an electronics store and got her a nice stereo. Oh, she was thrilled to death. She loved that stereo. That is, until it was stolen. She went out one morning to go to work. Door was slightly ajar, and instead of a stereo, she found a hole in the console and some wires sticking out. We filed a police report, but of course we never saw that stereo again. Many of you have lost things that are valuable to you and important to you. Some of you, Jimmy, have suffered theft and serious theft. Some of you have had money in 401ks. And you've seen stock market go down and lose money. Some of you have had that favorite outfit, that lounge outfit you put on when you came in from work. Oh, you loved it until it was nothing but threads and you lost it. Maybe you've lost a wallet, lost your keys, lost other things valuable to you. In this morning's text, Jesus talks about losing things. He talks about theft. He talks about those favorite outfits becoming nothing but bare threads. He's not condemning owning things, but what he is teaching is that nothing, in this world last. You drive that brand new Saturn off the lot and it begins depreciating. Nothing in this world last. 2 Peter 3:10. The heavens will pass away with a roar and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved. And that doesn't just go for heavenly bodies. Same context. Peter talks about the elements burning fervent heat. Everything is temporary. Everything we see, everything we touch, everything we think, temporary, doesn't last. And Jesus talks about the temporary nature of what we possess in this morning's text. He does so to make an extremely important point. And that is that heaven is worth everything. If you don't hear another word I say this morning, if you sleep through the rest of the message, I want you to get that. That heaven is worth everything. No matter the struggle, no matter the cost, no matter what you must do in this life to gain that crown of life, heaven is worth everything. That's the Lord's message. Matthew 6, 19. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth. Now, understand, the Lord is not condemning treasures on earth. He's not condemning that 401k planning for retirement. He's not condemning the house, the car, the clothes, the other thing that we possess and have. That's not his point. His point is those things are temporary. They don't last. Don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy. Clothing was a major source of wealth in ancient Palestine. You gathered clothes up as part of your material possessions, as part of what you owned and part of your treasure. Moths would destroy it. And obviously, once a moth destroyed the clothing, it was gone. It was worthless. Where moth and rust destroy. The Greek word for rust literally is eating. Many of the newer translations put the word vermin here instead of rust. Eating. And Jesus likely means both ideas. Vermin that would eat your food, your clothes, your other possessions, as well as rust that would render other possessions worthless. In other words, anything that would eat away at what you have renders it worthless. Those who had the means to do so in antiquity would bury their coins. Obviously, rust would destroy those coins and ruin their value. Don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. Homes in ancient Palestine were made of mud brick walls. Well, no matter if you secured the door, if you put your treasures in the lockbox like people would do in antiquity, wouldn't take much to get in your house and to get it. All a thief would have to do was dig through the wall, and thieves would do so and go in and take whatever they wanted. It wasn't hard to do. Thieves would break in and steal. Moth, rust, vermin would destroy treasures. But lay up for yourselves, Jesus said, treasures in heaven. Treasures in heaven is that heavenly reward. It is at the judgment. Seeing that hand that is nail scarred, once nailed that old rugged cross, pick up that crown of life and to place it on your head and to say, well done, good and faithful servant. That is the treasure in heaven. where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. Instead of the temporary nature of the things of this world, the things of the next world are imperishable. They last forever. Peter said in 1 Peter that the things of heaven, that heaven is undefiled. That reward is undefiled, unfading. It lasts forever. It's not going to go away. Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. Where moth and rust do not destroy, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where you put your emphasis, where your life is, there your treasure will be also. If you emphasize in your life and are concerned about your possessions, the things that you have, that's where your treasure is. You're not heavenly minded. If all you care about is that 401k, your job, your clothing, the car, the house, everything in this world, if that is what you care about, you can't go to heaven if that's your emphasis. That's what Jesus said. For where your treasure is, there your heart is also. And again, those things of this world are not wrong. Don't misunderstand. But it's where the heart is. It's the things you care about. That's where your treasure is. You see, the point Jesus made was that heaven is worth everything. The things of this world don't matter. After all, they're going to burn up. They're not going to last. But the things of heaven last. Because of that, heaven is worth everything. Where your treasure is, there your heart is also. Jesus taught the same principle elsewhere, that heaven is the most important thing of all. You see, Jesus talked about the kingdom of heaven like a treasure hidden in a field. A man just happens to stumble on that treasure, and he goes and sells everything he owned to go and to buy that one treasure. That's how important the kingdom of heaven is. Another man was searching for pearls, and he found the perfect one. Pearl of great price. And he went and he sold everything he had. Everything to buy that one pearl. Now I want you to put yourselves in that man's shoes for just a moment. You find the perfect pearl. You find perhaps that great treasure in a field. What would you do to own it? Would you sell your car, your house, your wardrobe, all the knickknacks in your home, all the heirlooms, everything. Get rid of the 401k. Cash it out. Get rid of all your stocks. Get rid of every red cent in your checking account to go and buy it. That's what these men did. They got rid of everything they owned to go and buy that one thing. Because heaven is that valuable and it's worth everything. Get that through our hearts, into our minds, into our very soul. That heaven is worth everything. Well, how do you demonstrate in your life, by the way that you live, that heaven is worth everything? Well, first, you have to think about what is paramount in your life. You must think about what is paramount in your life. Let me ask you this. What are the most important things in your life this morning? Is the most important thing in your life your spouse? Your children? Your family? Your grandchildren? Is the most important thing in your life your job? Would you do anything to keep that job? Is it that important? What about your house? How important is maintaining that home that you own? How important is your car maintenance? Your exercise, diet routine? Yeah, I added that one for myself. How important is your pet? How important your clothing? What is the most important thing in your life? What matters more than anything else? Heaven must be far, far more important. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth. The things of this world are transient. They're not going to last. Heaven has to be the most important. The kingdom of heaven must come first. Matthew 16:24. If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself. Get rid of who he is. Folks, that's what Jesus said. Deny yourself. Forget who you are. Forget it and take on a new identity in Christ. Deny yourself. Take up His cross, that emblem of death in antiquity. The way they put people to death. Be like saying, pick up your electric chair. Pick up your cross and follow me. Put Him first. Luke 14:26. If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Jesus didn't say it's more difficult. Not what he said. He said, cannot be my disciple. Philippians 3, verse 8. Paul said, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. Everything as lost. My position in Judaism, my education, the feet of Gamaliel, my reputation, my family, my riches, my all, I count it as lost for the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For His sake, I have suffered the loss of some things, of all things, and count them as rubbish. That's a polite way of rendering what Paul said. I'll just be honest with you. The word there is dung. Even a little profane in antiquity. Yeah, that's what Paul said. I count everything that way, as a sewer. Dung. In order that I may gain Christ. Brothers and sisters, I'm so troubled by those who don't put the kingdom of God first. There are many who don't, who choose to do something else on Sunday. A lady in Kentucky I knew, if Kentucky were playing basketball, she wouldn't be at worship. Now, I understand the importance of Kentucky basketball. Do not misunderstand me. Brothers and sisters, it's first things first. First things first. It's not going to the lake. It's not doing whatever. You fill in the blank. It's God first. He must be paramount in life. And two, provisional. Provisional. Here's the point. I want you to understand that everything you hold dear, is temporary. It's not going to last. Let's think for a moment. You love your spouse with all your heart. That spouse is going to die. You love your children, your grandchildren with all your heart. They're going to grow up. They're going to leave home. They may move far away. You love that job. You work so hard to keep it. Well, the factory's going to move, or you're going to retire, or you're going to get fired. That job's going to come to an end. You love that house. It's going to burn down, or it's going to decay, or you're going to die and leave it. That car you spend so much time maintaining is going to run down. You're going to have to buy a new one. Jimmy, you're even going to have to buy a new truck at some point. Everything is going to decay. Everything you hold dear, you're going to lose. Everything. Understand it. Everything. You are going to leave everything behind. And even before you do so, you're going to lose much of what you value in this life. Nothing lasts forever. Psalm 102, 25 and 26. Of old you laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you will remain. They will all wear out like a garment. You will change them like a robe, and they will pass away. I've had to get a new wardrobe. Got a new outfit on this morning. It's going to wear out. That's the way it is. The house is going to run down. Car. Your money. Everything. It passes away. 1 Corinthians 7:31b, the second half of the verse. The present form of this world is passing away. Is passing away. 2 Corinthians 4:18. The things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. Things that are seen are transient. I don't want you to misunderstand me. It's right to work hard at the job. God created us to be a working people. You need to provide for your family. It's important to be good stewards of what God has given us. Maintain the house, the cars, so forth. It's right to love your family with all your heart. But understand, that cannot be where your treasure is. That can't be the most important thing in life. Brothers and sisters, since everything in this world is passing away, it is beyond foolish, to put our hope in stuff and to value stuff. Since the ball games are passing away, it's foolish to put that before God. Since the job is passing away, it's foolish to put that before God. Since family will not be here forever, it's foolish to put that before God. Since money will be lost, it's foolish to put that before God. Nothing is worth your soul. Nothing. Nothing is worth putting things before God. The kingdom of heaven must come first. It must. Above everything else. And number three, permanent. You know, I want you to understand, the things of this world are transient. The things that are seen are transient. But the second half of that verse says the things that are unseen are eternal. I want you to understand that the house, the cars, the job, the clothes, the money, the family, it's not going to last forever. But there are things that are eternal, that last forever and ever. Your treasure in heaven will never pass away. You know why that is? Because the God who gives that treasure is eternal. He never passes away. Deuteronomy 33:27. The eternal God is your refuge. Not the God here today, gone tomorrow. The eternal God is your refuge. Revelation 1:8. God Himself said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was And who is to come? The Almighty. When God revealed Himself to Moses at that burning bush, go tell the people of Israel, I am who I am. Tell them the I am has sent you. Not the I was. Not the I will be. The I am. Wherever we are in history, or when history is no more, or before history ever was, there is God. Eternal. The I am. The one who lasts forever and ever. Heaven never ends. But let me give you the flip side of that as well. Hell never ends. We're thinking positively this morning. Heaven never ends. 2 Peter 1:11. There will be richly provided for you an inheritance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I am angered what's going on in Ukraine. I'm really honestly beyond angry that some mad dictator would do that to innocent people. I'll just be blunt. I don't mean to be political, but it's just beyond sitting. If Ukraine falls, a temporary nation, temporary kingdom, there is an eternal kingdom. If Putin were to attack a NATO country, we were to be at war. If this nation were to fall, if it were, there is an eternal kingdom yet to come. One that shall never end. And there, my brothers, is our hope, our confidence, our assurance through no matter what happens in life, we shall be granted a place in the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So take some time and think about what the eternal kingdom of heaven will be like. What blessings will you have in that eternal kingdom where your treasure is? What treasures are you going to have? When you think about seeing the Lord Jesus face to face, when you think about gathering with loved ones around the throne of the Almighty, when God reaches His finger and wipes away every tear from your eye, when He does away with all sorrow, all sin, all evil, it's going to be worth everything. It will be worth everything you've endured in life. It will be worth giving up everything to follow Jesus. And it will never end. It's not going to be temporary. It's not going to be just for a million years. You understand, time will be no more, but as reference, it's not going to be for a million years. It's going to be forever. No, I can't wrap my head around that. But what a blessing that is. An eternal kingdom of bliss, of joy, of no more sin, no more sorrow, no more tears, no more death. What a glorious day that's going to be. Think about that. Think about those great treasures. And four, I want you to plan. I want you to plan. I want you to take time to contemplate how you're going to live because your treasure is in heaven. How is your life going to be different because your treasure is in heaven? How are you going to demonstrate practically treasure in heaven? What are you going to do of a morning? Because your treasure is in heaven. What are you going to do of an afternoon? Because your treasure is in heaven. What are you going to do of an evening? Because your treasure is in heaven. This afternoon, tomorrow, I want you to spend time answering those questions. What are you going to do of a morning, an afternoon, of an evening? When you get up, you're treating your family. How is your life going to be different because your treasure is in heaven? When you're at work, at the gym, at school, at the grocery store, at a friend's house, walking your dog, whatever, how is your life going to be different because your treasure is in heaven? How are you going to live? Because your treasure's in heaven. I tell you what. Think about those questions. Tomorrow. This afternoon. And then Tuesday. I want you to do an experiment. I want you to put those questions into practice. I want you to live differently in the morning. Because treasure is in heaven. I want you to live differently in the afternoon because treasure's in heaven. I want you to live differently of an evening because your treasure's in heaven. How are you going to treat people? How are you going to study Scripture or pray? How are you going to repent of sin? How are you going to structure your TV watching, your internet browsing, your life? Because treasure is not on this earth, but is in heaven. You understand answering these questions is right and good. But without action, you might as well be sitting in a rocking chair just going back and forth and doing nothing. It doesn't matter. You know that absolutely nothing in life, nothing, gets done if you just plan. You know, if you sit there and you think, I ought to get up and do housework, and you don't, well, you know, it doesn't accomplish anything. If you think, well, I'm going to make this investment, this 401k, and you don't do it, it goes up, you know. You think, I want to start dieting and exercising, you don't. Well, what's better to do? If you think, I'm going to follow Jesus, I'm going to structure my life differently because treasure's in heaven, and you never do it, it is worthless. It doesn't matter. The Lord's own fleshly brother wrote in James 1:22, be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. Be doers of the word. This morning, I want you to urge you to do that very thing. Not to think, not just to ponder, although there's a good place for that. I've urged you to do that. But after you think, after you ponder, after you search your heart, you better act. You better act. Because you want your treasure in heaven. I know you do. You want that crown of life. And there's only one way to get it. Put your faith not in things where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But to lay up treasure in heaven. Moth and rust do not destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. This morning, where's your treasure? What's the most important thing in your life? What do you value? Is God really preeminent in the way that you live? Is everything you do centered around Him? Centered around honoring the God of heaven, the God who gave His Son to die for you? Oh, this morning, if you need to reorient your life, we're ready to help you. I'm not here to judge. That's not our role. We're here to love. We're here to help. If we can help you in any way, won't you let us know right now as we stand and sing?